Hi, and welcome to our 10:30 press conference, Using Music to Advance Geoscience Research. Our speakers today are Paul Williams at the University of Reading, Jeffrey Lee from Texas Tech University, and Matthew Burtner from the University of Virginia.
Okay, good morning, everyone, and thank you for coming to this slightly different than usual AGU press conference. My name is Paul Williams. I'm a professor of atmospheric science at the University of Reading. And usually when I'm giving a press conference, it's about my work on how climate change is causing the atmosphere to become more turbulent and how airplane rides are becoming bumpier. But I've been getting a bit frustrated recently at how the science that I do is not really moving people, not connecting with people emotionally. And that's kind of surprising because science is meant to be a description of nature. Nature does move people. And the reason science doesn't is it involves a level of abstraction, a certain detachment from the subject, an objectivity that kind of strips out the possibility of an emotional connection. And that, for me, is exemplified pretty well in, I can't seem to move the slide forward, in one of my favorite poems. Yeah, I'm doing that. No. Okay, thank you. One of my favorite poems by Walt Whitman, When I Heard the Learned Astronomer. This tells the story of someone who is sitting in a lecture theater, listening to, one imagines, a very eminent scientist talking about the stars. So it's full of equations, calculations, charts, facts and figures, and the person in the audience is really not feeling engaged and actually stands up halfway through the lecture and walks out of the room and just goes out into the night and looks up at the stars and finds that a much more meaningful experience. I think a number of scientists now are realizing that we need to re-establish some kind of emotional connection with the public and the science that we do. And one way of doing that is to look at the different ways in which geophysical phenomena are represented in the arts, which could be poetry, theater, ballet, the visual arts, painting, or music in our case. And the suggestion that there might be a connection between science and music is, of course, nothing new. Einstein, famously, and there's documented evidence of this, when he was stuck and really failing to get to the bottom of a scientific problem, would seek refuge and inspiration in music, playing the violin here. It's quoted in the New York Times from 1930 as saying that music and science are related because they have a common aim of expressing the unknown. And he also said that if he wasn't a scientist, he would probably have been a musician, thinking in terms of music and daydreaming and seeing his life in terms of music. I'm going to tell you about two studies we've done looking at the different ways in which weather and climate phenomena are represented first in classical music and then in popular music. This is work led by my collaborator, Dr. Karen Applin from the University of Oxford. We've identified 35 different classical compositions that depict different kinds of weather, going back to 1723, Vivaldi's famous Four Seasons, and the most recent piece in our database is from the year 2000, Maxwell Davies' Antarctic Symphony. So let me give you an example. There's an opera by Berlioz called The Trojans, and the piece called The Royal Hunt and Storm, which describes a sudden summer rainstorm. Two lovers are out having fun and are hit by this rainstorm and have to take shelter in a cave. And there's a brilliant passage in the music where the raindrops are represented by plucked violins and violas. Another example from Richard Strauss would be the Alpine Symphony, which describes a day when two hikers, or a number of hikers, in fact, encounter a sudden thunderstorm at the summit of a mountain. I'll play you a clip from this piece. The weather starts out very calm, and then about 30 seconds into the piece, you really can't miss the deluge and the sudden downpour of rain when this thunderstorm strikes. A I think this might be a first, actually, playing a piece of music in an AGU press conference. So the clouds are maybe rolling in at this point, sun disappearing. So, what have we found? Well, we've analysed our database of classical compositions and found actually that it's bad weather that is most frequently represented. It's storms, winds, clouds, rain, the nice weather, sunny conditions, fair weather, the northern lights, the aurora are really not very frequently represented. And we think that is a sign of the fact that bad weather is used by composers as a very convenient allegory for representing the emotional turbulence that is in the piece of music. We've also done an analysis of the different nationalities of the composers who've represented weather in the music. And this is very interesting because most of the composers at the time came from continental Europe, France, Germany, Austria. And yet it's British composers who seem to, you know, represent music at least twice as much as anyone from any other nationality. And that's, I don't think, because the authors of the study are British, I don't think there's a bias from that. I think it is just fitting the national stereotype of British people being obsessed by the weather. That seems to be reflected in the compositional output from British composers as well. And then we've done the same kind of thing in popular music, which is, of course, much more accessible. Many more people listen to pop music than classical music, so it reaches a wider audience. The clue's in the name. Classical music was never popular. We went to a karaoke database and did a keyword search through the lyrics of thousands of songs going back to the 1950s. 759 of those songs contained a reference to a kind of weather. We were curious about whether there was a connection between the incidence of weather events in songs, or the incidence of weather events in the real world and in the songs as they're being depicted. So, for example, we know that the 1950s and 1960s in the US had a lot of severe weather, lots of named hurricanes. In contrast, the two-decade period following the 50s and 60s, the 70s and 80s, were much quieter. And we were curious about whether we could find any evidence that that climatological difference over that four-decade period was represented in the songs that were being written. And indeed, we found evidence of that. 73% of songs written in the 50s and 60s that had weather references, 73% of them mentioned storms, wind, rain, hurricanes, bad weather. Whereas the songs that were written in the 70s and 80s, only 46% of them had these keywords in, and that's a statistically significant difference. So it does really seem to be the case that songwriters are writing about the weather that they're experiencing on the day they write the song. And in the same way that we have a climatological record of temperature from ice cores, it seems there's also a kind of a climate record in music as well. And I can't give a press conference about music in New Orleans without mentioning Hurricane Katrina and the dozens of songs that have been written inspired by Katrina. I'm listing 10 of them here from a very diverse bunch of songwriters and singers, from Harry Connick Jr. to Snoop Dogg, Norah Jones, Stevie Wonder, Green Day, and U2, a cover of The Saints Are Coming. So we think that musical output, both classical and popular, is linked to the contemporary meteorological environment. And that tells me that music's unique ability to connect with listeners could be exploited to communicate the geosciences to a broader audience. We know, for example, that students, at university and college learn better and have better marks at the end of the semester if those concepts are linked to music. And I have a colleague at the University of Georgia, Athens, who begins every lecture with a piece of music that's relevant to the topic of that lecture. And finally, mentioning climate change, our work is giving us a catalogue, a baseline, if you like, of mostly pre-climate change weather. But it's possible that climate change in future will lead, for example, to more severe weather, and we might see that represented in terms of more references in popular music to rain, wind, storm, hurricanes. We'll see, but our work will provide a baseline for comparison. There are a couple of papers that I've left in the back row. Feel free to take a copy and or contact me for more information. That's where I'll leave it.
Okay, well, I'm going to take us from Berlioz to Woody Guthrie. Most of my work is on wind erosion and related phenomena, but just for fun, I started looking at music expressing erosion. And where's the foreword? Okay. In the 1930s, there was a combination of severe drought, the Great Depression, and farming practices used in the Southern Plains that all led to the worst wind erosion and dust storms that this country has ever seen. And it was worst in the Dust Bowl region, the red circle there, of the Southern Plains. And I went wrong. Some people distinguish between environmental disaster and environmental catastrophe, whereas a disaster is a natural hazard that significantly affects people, but more or less in the short term, months or years. Presumably, Hurricane Harvey will be an example of that. An environmental catastrophe, on the other hand, is a disaster that affects people where it's permanent. It's the extreme example would be Pompeii after the eruption of Vesuvius. Now, in the 1930s, a lot of people saw the Dust Bowl region as permanently destroyed, and so it was seen as a catastrophe. But after the 30s, there was recovery, and so we would think of it more in terms of a disaster. And I'd like to show a couple examples of how music reflects this difference. Now, blowing dust is still significant in the region, but it is far, far less intense than it was during the 1930s and a few times after that. But we still, dust and dust storms are a major part of the collective consciousness of people living in the region still. So Woody Guthrie, probably America's greatest folk singer, lived in the Dust Bowl in the Texas Panhandle during the 1930s, and he wrote a number of songs related to that. One of his best known is "So Long It's Been Good to Know You."
Blocked out the traffic and blocked out the sun. Straight for home all the people did run, singing "So long, it's been good to know ye. So long, it's been good to know ye. So long, it's been good to know ye. This dusty old dust is a-getting my home. I've got to be drifting along."
And later in the same song, "I can do this."
"Sweethearts sat in the dark and sparked. They hugged and kissed in that dusty old dark. They sighed and cried, hugged and kissed. Instead of marriage, they talk like this. Honey, so long, been good to know ye. So long, it's been good to know ye. So long, it's been good to know ye. This dusty old dust is a-getting our home, and I've got to be drifting along."
Now, in the interest of time, I'll just read lyrics from one of his other Dust Bowl songs. I've seen the wind so high that it blowed my fences down. I've seen the wind so high that it blowed my fences down, buried my tractor 6 feet underground. Well, it turned my farm into a pile of sand. Yes, it turned my farm into a pile of sand. I had to hit the road with a bottle in my hand. I had a gal, she was young and sweet. I had a gal, she was young and sweet, but a dust storm buried her 1,600 feet. She was a good gal, long, tall, and stout. Yes, she was a good gal, long, tall, and stout. I had to get a steam shovel just to dig my darling out. Others in the 30s, a lot of cowboy songs brought in dust storms. One of Roy Rogers' early movies included a song called Dust. Dust, dust, dust in the skies, dust on the trail, dust in my eyes. Dust, dust, can't see the sun, can't find my way, the dust is one. Oh Lord, please ease my pain, oh Lord, where is your rain and sunshine? Dust, dust, must it be, can this be eternity? Oh Lord, have mercy on poor me. Well, by the end of the 30s, the region recovered. There were better conservation methods that the farmers had learned during the time. There was a war economy, so crop prices increased greatly, and rain returned to the region. The drought ended. And so dust continued in music after that, and just a couple examples. Joe Carr and Alan Mundy have a song called Welcome to West Texas.
Welcome to West Texas. There's music in the air. Dust, clouds, a tornado or two, no telling what's up there. Well, the wind outside is howling, coyotes crying fear. Welcome to West Texas, you're gonna like it here. You wake up in a dust storm, at noon it starts to rain. The front blows through at a quarter past two, at three, it's sunny again.
And later in the same song.
Don't worry about breathing dust in. Scientific research shows West Texas dust is so big that it won't fit in your nose.
Okay. I think we have time for this one. Another by the same duo.
Windy days and dusty skies, dusty teardrops fill my eyes. You better close your windows when that old West Texas wind blows. I lost my baby in these dusty skies. I woke up in the morning, there were dust clouds in the sky. Found a letter by the window that only said goodbye. I looked in all directions, but she's nowhere to be found. Now there's more dirt in the air than there is down on the ground. Windy days.
Okay, well, that song, he loses his sweetheart to the dust. Sonny Curtis, another singer and songwriter from the region, countered that with a song about a dust storm blows in, so he goes to a bar to get out of it, and that's where he meets his girl. But he ends the song with, when the wind gets up, you can hear that old panhandle groan, kicking up dust with a gust and a Texas moan. But that's my home, that's my home. And that's the way it goes when Amarillo blows. Again, the idea of it's just part of living. Butch Hancock, the wind's gonna blow tomorrow just like it blowed today, and someday when your bones turn to dust, the wind's gonna blow you away. Okay, so to tie this up, the 1930s were a defining time for the region, and dust storms were a major part of that, and this is reflected in the music. In the 30s, the songs reflected destruction of the region, an environmental catastrophe, but since the 1930s, the songs treat dust just as a nuisance at worst or part of the collective consciousness. So, with that, I'll stop. Thank you.
Hello. I'm going to talk about some new eco-acoustic music techniques today. I'm an eco-acoustician and a sound artist. Using the instruments or the techniques of geosciences as my musical instruments. The method that I use that we call ecoacoustics fundamentally is about bridging, using new technologies to bridge research in the sciences and research in music. When the subject of this research is about things that the public cares deeply about, for example, global warming, mass extinction, rising sea levels, the combined efforts of science and music together can be a cultural mover in a way I think that either one can't be by itself. So, for example, as a composer, I might use a violin, or I might use a glacier as my musical instrument. But which instrument is going to be the most resonant with a public in a time of global warming and ice melting? So I choose to use the glaciers, and of course we might use the violins as well. Ecoacoustics has basically three different techniques that are depicted here on this slide. Field recording, that is gathering the vibration energy from the world. Sonification, which is about converting data into sound. And then live interaction with natural materials. That's a very important part of music in the Anthropocene, the human nature interaction aspect of it. And that's where we get to play music with the environment. Today I'm talking about two new techniques, sound casting and sonic physiographies. Sound casting is a way of collapsing sonic space in order to understand the acoustic forces of change across a system. So this is a glacier called Matanuska, and it's a glacier that I've been working on for many years. And when I go to the glacier, I deploy microphones across the surface of it, many, many microphones on the face of the glacier, but also in the crevices and under the water and inside the ice itself, so that we can capture a resonance of this glacier in a way that we can't hear with our ears, but then we bring all that into another space, for example, into a studio or a laboratory or into a concert hall or a gallery. And so here is, you know, for example, one of the microphones out there recording. Another one is inside the water in the ice. And they're all recording in real time so that you capture a massively multi-channel representation of this glacier. So one microphone might sound like this, or does sound like this. But then when you put together all the channels, you create a much more a system of representation of the broader ice movement of this glacier. This one contains maybe 19 different microphones, and you can hear in this the bands of the surface water, but also the crevice sound underwater, and then you can hear the inner ice deformations all mixed together into a single audio representation of the glacier. And then expanding on the ecoacoustics aspect, then I'll compose music to that system, drawing out certain characteristics of it. So here is the same piece, now soundcast of Matanuska Glacier with the instruments playing over that sound file. Thank you. I put the sounds and the slides and the images on the press website, so if you want to listen to this again or any more of this stuff, for the space of time, I'll be kind of compressing and moving past things. So if sound casting collapses space into in order to understand the physiography of a system, there are other techniques to deal with time, and so the temporal dimension of environmental sound is also a rich tool, rich medium for exploring exploring these systems. So in sonic physiography of a time-stretched glacier, I take a temporal approach and slow the glacial movement down, slow down the melting of it. People say that glaciers move slowly, but in fact they move way too fast. And this piece uses a percussionist, performs as part of the interactive system, and the input of the percussionist time stretches the glacial melt in real time. So the performer and the glacier are interacting together. And here's a little excerpt from the piece. Just show you how I get there. Here's the original sound. Sounds familiar by now. We're listening to glacial melt runoff. And then time stretched by two times. And then time stretched by four times, becoming eight, so slowing down. And then amplifying the resonance that you start hearing in the time-stretched glacier. Oh no. Okay, so it's time-stretched about eight times, but then the resonance is being amplified. And then removing the noise. And this is that process is mirrored in the percussion that moves from noisy instruments towards pitched instruments, in this case from cymbals and rattles to a vibraphone. Put this link to a YouTube video in the slide. These images that accompany the piece are taken inside the glacier. I took them using a macro lens inside the glacier, kind of a representation of the time stretching. And then I also have a SoundCloud page, and the group Ecosono that I work for does environmental sound has a video page. And then the university that supports my research, the University of Virginia, and the music department there is listed here. Thank you.
Now we will take questions from reporters in the audience. If you have a question, please raise your hand and state your name and affiliation. Are there any questions from reporters?
Just a quick one for Mr. Burtner. Where is this glacier?
These are from two different glaciers. One of them is the second one is Root Glacier. It's in Wrangell, St. Elias. And then the first one, Matanuska Glacier, is north of Anchorage towards Denali.
Okay.
Ike, it's Stoltz, Atlas Obscura for Dr. Lee. Fascinated by your distinction between catastrophe and disaster. Of course, what the government did re the Dust Bowl had a lot to do with making sure it didn't become a permanent catastrophe. But is it possible that Woody Guthrie's jaunty attitude also had some impact on that question?
I have no idea.
Are there any other questions?
Hey, Rob Meyer for The Atlantic. I think this is a question for Matthew. I wonder how you think about like the audience for your work and where it's performed vis-a-vis. There are a number of other composers, like John Luther Adams, who comes to mind, who also write about like the Arctic, but I think do it maybe with a less sonification. You know, there's less kind of data. It's more like inspiration. I wonder how you just think about yourself in that galaxy, and also think about who you know you're writing for and what that performance context looks like. Thanks.
Yeah, great question. Luckily it's a rich field with a lot of people working on issues of climate change, and in particular in the Arctic, which has been really great to have really prominent artists working in the Arctic, such as John Luther Adams and others. My own inspiration in this comes more from the technology side. So I was inspired by people like Barry Truax and Hildegard Westerkamp and Ioannis Xenakis with an X in the 1970s, who used scientific systems mapped into musical pieces. And then more recently, there's an excellent group of people working on this kind of technology-enabled science music collaboration. People like David Monaki, who is also an eco-acoustician, working on extinction, and Daniel Blinkhorn in Australia, who works on the Arctic, as well as Africa, some, and then Leah Barclay, who's also in Australia, who's working a lot with the northern Australian rainforest areas. The music is, you know, it's a really interesting question. I mean, of course, as a musician, I'm performing or presenting my work in the places where music is played, and most of my focus has been on in the collaboration with scientists has been imagining how that may help disseminate the knowledge that's produced at places, you know, like AGU. If without kind of overstating that, it's just wherever music is performed could be a venue for science as well, with this kind of music. So it's happening. Well, so by the same token, the music fits very well into scientific context. So I've done music for science videos and science functions. My music, the State Department asked me to present my music or have it as the background for Obama's trip to Alaska. They wanted to use music of climate change for that particular presentation, and that was a really exciting venue in which to present this kind of work, very relevant. And it's also played in concerts and in radios and in galleries, the places where music is presented.
Are there any other questions? Are there any questions on the chat? No? Okay, great. That concludes our press conference. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next up at 11:30 is the North Korea nuclear test.